senza niente, uh-huh, quello tradizionale di Reggio, quello è
più ok, ok,
pecorino marzolino,
bello,
del Tillo, sheep cheese really fresh, really good, fig and pear mustard, this is a medium age pecorino from Chianti with a white truffle.
So imagine this is a dinner party. You could throw a few hazelnuts around here, a little salad in a corner, breads with a melted cheese on it. Dopo fa vedere anche tuo jelly. Okay, so this is how you could do like for a party. So I would start with this one, which is a cheese that's made by the artisan cheesemaker. I would put the fig or the pear. These are spicy like a wasabi rush. Yeah, you may need to use your fingers. That's balsamic vinegar jelly. But this is fig, that's pear, and that cheese is only made in the springtime when sheep eat a special milk, and it's only available for a month or two.
It's so sweet.
Called Marzolino. It starts being made in March, and it's maybe 3 or 4 days old.
And then this is an aged pecorino, medium aged pecorino with the truffle honey. So you can see how you do a shop to have a dinner party. And then I'm
trying. Oh my God, that is delicious.
The 4-year-old by itself. That's cow's milk, this was sheep's milk, that's sheep's milk. And then this is that 25-year-old, most people don't know, but there's two cities allowed to make balsamic vinegar. One is Modena, the other is Reggio Emilia. And this is the bottle the people from Reggio Emilia use. And you can see how thick it just sits. That's your traditional.
So, wow, yeah, it's like a little glob.
And that's your appetizer. Might be $25 in New York.
Oh.
This one guy that makes what I would call a fake balsamic, but it's made by someone who makes a traditional. He makes that jelly you tasted.
Mm-hmm.
This is their younger one. That's only $14.50 for this size. Saba is the grape juice that balsamic vinegar is made out of. Look at the salt collection.
That's salt?
Yes. Now these in Whole Foods in New York are like $35 a jar. Here they're 10 euros a jar, but also she sells them by weight. So this is like a red one from Hawaii. This is from India. The Murray salt from Australia, the beautiful Himalayan from the mountains that you could get in crystals or rocks. The fleur de sel is the first shaving, the first salt crystals that form in the water, and they almost like have an effervescent, bubbly kind of finish in your tongue. So a lot of people are using those on chocolate.
And also good on chocolate?
It's very good on chocolate. It's good on steak, and it's what we call a finishing salt, where you just sprinkle it on something when you're done with it. So we in America, there's a couple people like Franz in Seattle, and she does a salt caramel where the salt's already in the caramel,
mm-hmm,
and then covers it in chocolate and puts 2 grains of the sea salt on top. So you get this beautiful sea
also
salt.
This one, it's a bar, it's a milk chocolate
with
and
sea salt.
Sea
milk
salt.
Chocolate and sea salt's really
wow.
Good. David Lebovitz in Paris does like a caramel with chocolate and then toasted almonds and sea salt.
You can eat this by itself, like it's so good.
Uh-huh.
Because it's crispy,
mm-hmm,
it's not too salty.
No, it's not.
No, so when nice. You put it on things, it's kind of exciting in your mouth.
Yeah.
Like just a little cherry tomato. Already is an appetizer with 2 grains of salt and a good olive oil.
Can you sprinkle on a salad too?
Anything.
Wow.
But just needs so much less. So, but then the Danish smoked is really nice. The Viking smoked is really beautiful. There's one with like the algae, the plants, vanilla, and fleur de sel.
Mm.
So if you even buy just a plain sea salt, you could crush things in it, and like the truffle salt, it absorbs the fragrances, and then you're using more, like we do an herbal salt, herbs instead of salt.
Okay.
Sea salt has more minerals than sodium. So you're more satisfied because of the flavor content, mm-hmm, and you actually use less salt. So we're going up to the Sicilian family here. Benita is her name.
Okay.
And I have her grilled marinated eggplant on my recipe. They're geniuses with eggplant. She probably has them 12 different ways. She works with her 2 sons and her granddaughter. When she was in Sicily, her husband had to go to Germany to work because there was no money. And the mafia came in. She was running a restaurant even back then. And the mafia guy came to her and said, if you sleep with me, we'll let you keep the restaurant. And she grabbed her kids, closed the restaurant, and moved up here in the 60s. And then she finally opened up a little trattoria. When I first moved here in the 80s, when I saw her, she had a little stand here where she could only serve drinks.
That's it?
But she had a secret skillet in the back, and the working boys would bring like a fish or a pork chop, and she'd cook for them. And now look at this. Now this is her restaurant. And it's all out of one tiny little kitchen. What she does, you see here, remember we saw that fresh pasta?
Yeah.
She buys all the fresh pasta in the corner, and then the one son does all the sauces. Fresh pasta takes a minute to cook. That's really easy. And look at her beautiful, oh my God, look at that risotto. Che bello. So look at the beautiful risotto. That's her caponata, which is a Sicilian stew. Eggplants and zucchini and bell peppers. See, she even has tripe today. Her fried eggplant, her eggplant parmesan. And then she makes custom sandwiches. Look at her roast beef. But what they're really famous for here, too, that he specializes in, are his porchetta sandwiches.
Oh, yeah.
It's really funny. There's Benita right there, Mama. Ciao.
Ciao.
The place is called Porks. Remember that old movie in America,
yeah.
Porky's? So they kind of took that as a name. And look, he's paper-thin slices the roast pork and does the sandwiches for you. The porchetta sandwiches.
Oh, ciao.
And then there's her grilled marinated eggplant. In winter, she does a grilled marinated eggplant that's really beautiful. Okay, lunchtime.
Okay, let's go eat.
Since we had our taste buds invested in a Florentine steak today, I came back the next day for lunch at Porks and gave the tripe sandwich a try. It's not like we can get this at home. So I sat at the counter and, minus the camera, the tourist gear, and my lack of Italian language skills, I felt like one of the locals. How can I describe the tripe sandwich? Well, there's really no describing it other than soft and beefy, with a bun absorbing much of the juice. It's a very simple, traditional, inexpensive, yet very filling lunch, and like most sandwiches, perfect on the go.
Very good.
Truth be told, had I ventured into the central market on my own, I would have missed out on everything. To really get a full experience of the local food, culture, and traditions, you need someone knowledgeable and experienced to guide you through the labyrinth of shops and educate you on the plethora of products and food that's inside this huge market. As much as I'm a do-it-yourself kind of a traveler, I would not attempt to go through this amazing market without Judy. No way. And by not getting the most out of the San Lorenzo market, you'd miss out on the secret ingredients of Florence. Sampling our way through the market left me hungry for more, more like a Florentine steak. Volare, oh, cantare, oh, oh, nel blu, dipinto di blu, venite di stare lassù. Until next time. Ciao for now.